Howdy, folks, live from Big Top Chautauqua. Welcome to another episode of Tent Show Radio. Funding support for Tent Show Radio is provided by the Bayfield Inn. Stay, dine, and relax year-round on the shoreline of Lake Superior in downtown Bayfield. Any traveler, any season, any meal, your view awaits. More info at thebayfieldinn.com. And by the Bayfield Chamber of Commerce, beautiful Bayfield in the Apostle Islands. You can tour sea caves and shop our galleries and stores on the shores of Lake Superior. Info at lodging at bayfield.org. And by the Ashland Chamber of Commerce, Ashland, Wisconsin, where you can social distance naturally. For year-round fun, visit ashland.com. And now, here's your host of Tent Show Radio, best-selling author, humorist, singer-songwriter, Michael Perry.
Howdy, folks, and welcome to Tent Show Radio from Lake Superior, Big Top, Chautauqua. Oh, what a treat tonight, especially if you love acoustic guitars doing things no mere mortal can make them do, as our featured artists are Tommy Emmanuel and Leo Kottke. And if the guitars weren't enough, the stories these two tell are worth the price of admission. And a little later on, I'll share a story, contrasting my guitar skills with theirs, as if such a thing were necessary. I will be invoking both the words humility and heinous. Folks, the music you're about to hear emanates from a special space and a special place. The Big Top is just that, a grand blue and pearl gray striped canvas beauty suitable for a circus, but in this case, home to a history of live performance centered on the stage. The Big Top seats are set directly on the earth, and what a spot of earth it is. High atop a hill overlooking Bayfield, Wisconsin, Lake Superior, and those all-natural waterbound wonders, the Apostle Islands. If you enjoy that vision, if you enjoy what you hear over the course of the next hour and want to see and experience it firsthand, please get to know us at www.bigtop.org. It sounds beautiful up here because it is beautiful up here. You ought to come on up. I don't know what to say about Tommy Emmanuel at this point. His Australian backstory could fill a brace of books, and on his Wikipedia page, the list of artists he's collaborated with will wear out your scrolling finger. I guess I'd settle for just two things: the astounding facility he demonstrates on a guitar, and the joy with which he does so. I mean, if you're a guitar string, you quake in fear when you hear him coming. But as an audience member tonight, or in the seats back in that evening in 2006, well, rather than explain, let's put you in those seats right now for an uplifting show with the amazing Tommy Emmanuel.
God bless. Thank you. All right. Now, this is my first time in Wisconsin, and thank you for your warm welcome.
Yeah.
Groove time now. Thank you. spill my drink. Wisconsin. God bless you all. Thank you. Thank you so much and welcome, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you. It's so nice to be here, and thanks for turning on the beautiful weather for me. And I've just had a 5-day break with my eldest daughter, Amanda. Which reminds me, I better play her song. We went to the Channel Islands, just the between England and France. We went to Jersey, and well, not New Jersey, the original Jersey, not the new one, the old one, where the cows are, where the milk tastes like milk. It's not called half and half. It's actually real milk and real butter. It's yellow. And the cows go moo, as opposed to fff, 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 fff. Anyway, enough of that gay banter. And for the first time in my life, I left my guitar at home. So I just had a 5-day break, which is the longest I've ever been without one of these cradled in my arms. And so this is my first show back, and I've been looking forward to it so much, I can tell you. And when we arrived here this afternoon, I took a walk down to Lake Superior and sang the first two verses of the record, the Edmund Fitzgerald, you know. The legend lives on the Chippewa and down to the big lake they call Gitchigumee. The lake, it is said, never gives up its dead when the gales of November come early. Isn't that beautiful? Yeah. Man. I've been a big Gordon Lightfoot fan ever since I could afford to buy a cassette. And he was a big influence on me. But, you know, I've always wanted to come to Lake Superior. I've always looked at that part of America and said, look at those lakes. I got to go there. Not in winter, but I got to go. So, anyway, so... I'd like to play a song for you that I wrote on a plane trip one time between London and Auckland, New Zealand. And I was missing my daughter a lot at that time, and this song kind of kept my spirits up. And I didn't have a title for it, and I'd been in Auckland about 3 days. Leo Kottke and I were playing some shows there, and it's nice to be in his neighborhood for a change too. I got a fax under my door, and it was from Amanda, my daughter, and it said, "Dear Dad, I've always thought of you." And I thought it was such a beautiful thing to say, and a beautiful way of saying, "I'm thinking of you and I miss you." It was, "I've always thought of you." And I said, that's what this song's about. And there's the title right there. So music by T. Emmanuel, title by A. Emmanuel, "I've always thought of you, Dad." Time for a little boogie-woogie. I started playing the guitar, oh, it must have been about half an hour ago. Oh, it's 45 minutes already. It must be a good show. I'm only serious. I started playing back in 1959. My mum and dad gave me a cheap guitar with cowboys painted on it sitting around the campfire. The smoke curling up like that. It was very, very cool. You know, one of the things I love about being a musician is the pay. No, is the, sorry. What other calling, what other art form, what other profession do people like me who came from nowhere get to meet the people who built what it is that we all love? People like Chet Atkins and Duane Eddy and Hank Marvin from The Shadows and Noki Edwards from The Ventures and that. They all became friends and I got to meet them and got to play with them. And it's just like, I think about young painters these days, if only they could go and visit with Picasso or if piano players could go visit with Mozart. Of course, they'd all their pants, but anyway. But, you know, that's one of the things I love about what I do. Just wanted to digress for a second. Now, back to Guitar Boogie. So anyway, oh, I'm jet-lagged. It's coming on now, babe. It's good too, man. Cheapest drugs I ever had. Just take a long flight. But my brother and I wanted electric guitars, you know, and we pestered our dad. Finally, he said, okay, and we'll get you electric guitars. So out he goes. This is 1960, by the way. He buys these two beautiful electric guitars and comes home and says, there you are, boys, let's hear it. And we said, thanks, Dad, where's the amp? And Dad said, what's an amp? We said, well, this is an electric guitar, but the sound goes down a wire and comes out down there. And he said, oh, we can't afford an amp. I had to mortgage the house to buy these two guitars. Some home, huh? Anyway, eventually, my brother and I figured out that if we pushed hard enough with the end of the neck here against our mother's walnut wardrobe, that we could get it to resonate and get a noise. Of course, when Dad saw the marks on the wardrobe, he got us resonating, I can tell you, around the ears. So we eventually got our amp, and what an amp, ladies and gentlemen, what an amp it was. 10 watts of sheer distortion. You turn it on and it go, and you hadn't even plugged into it. That's just the noise it made. So, because it didn't take us long to figure out how to blow the damn thing up, and we did. And this is leading me to a Guitar Boogie, which I'm going to spank this plank for you. Guitar Boogie is a 12-bar blues in E, and if you'd like to sing along, please don't. You'll ruin the whole thing, okay? So here we go. I'm only serious.
Thank you.
very much. Thank you. I thoroughly deserve that. Thank you. Here's a song I wrote in Africa. I went to Kenya to visit children that I've been sponsoring through World Vision. And I had a wonderful time. And while I was rattling my way across the Rift Valley, in the back of the smelliest and dustiest old four-wheel drive, with my heart just overflowing, I wrote this tune. I hope you like it. It's called Mombasa. It's dedicated to little Michael Kiyoko.
Welcome to intermission, folks. I begin tonight's tale with humility, and we'll get around to guitars. Humility can be cultivated or imposed. Today, we will speak of the latter. I have long said I prefer to run close to the dirt, as eventually we all fall, and why not lessen the drop? This requires humility in word, action, and comportment. Not necessarily the most popular move in this, the age of self-promoting go-getters. At this juncture, it is fair to point out I have more than one social media account set up for the sole purpose of self-promotional go-getting. It is also fair to observe that he who writes of humility and records that writing to share over the airwaves is, at some level, sending mixed messages. So much for cultivation. Let us switch to imposition. To humility served right to your face, spoon-fed if you're fortunate, but sometimes by the shovelful, and delivered, as with the two anecdotes to follow, in the form of friendly fire. As it happens, both incidents involve music. My music. The music I humbly compose and humbly play and less than humbly self-promote. One needs to feed the band. The band in question comprises true professionals, save one. Me. The other members have long honed their craft. I am a late arriving four-chord clammer. Everyone in the ensemble, including me, acknowledges that I have every honest reason to remain humble about my musicianship. Never was this more succinctly put than during preparations for our last pre-pandemic show. While sorting out the stage plot and plugins, a new sound tech, not familiar with my skill level, asked my pal and band director, Evan, "Does Mike play guitar?" Without hesitation and within earshot, Evan replied, "Mike has a guitar." As he spoke the words, his face was lit with evil delight. There were guffaws all around. Fast forward to last night. I've composed a new song. The band and I have recorded it, a videographer and I have shot a video to accompany it, and I am reviewing the work on our living room flat screen. My wife and younger daughter have joined me. I turn the volume up and we are halfway through the second pass when there comes a thudding in the hallway from above, and shortly, my elder daughter emerges at the base of the stairs with a look like the soup is off and says, "What is this heinous music you're playing?" The duality of parenting imbues us with the ability to love the child who so humbles us. It also imbues us with the ability to flip the script in an instant. Rather than flop to frown or purse in a pout, my face lit up, mirroring my pal Evan's evil delight. Because in the split-second instant after her question hung in the air, and before she realized who was singing, I realized I was going to be able to hang this one over her head in perpetuity. "It's my new song," I said. Listener, she hit reverse so fast it stripped her gears and she just spun. We laughed and laughed. The three of us, and then the four of us. Humility for two, joy for all. And now for another man who has a guitar. Does he ever? The show you're about to hear was recorded in 1998, but remains blindingly fresh. It's the fingerpicking genius Leo Kottke. Just as with Tommy Emmanuel, the joy of this performance is double-barreled. There is the music, the mastery of the music, but there's also the storytelling, woven so very naturally and humorously. The perfect backdrop for a perfect night in the perfect venue. It's a Big Top revisitation of Minnesota's own Leo Kottke. We'll be right back.
I'd like to, as some of you know, I ordinarily at this point explain why I have nothing to say and why I speak despite the fact that I have nothing to say. But I've gotten tired of saying that and so have some audiences. So I've done some research and, beyond the usual stuff which I have mentioned before, how are you doing, let's rock and roll, are you feeling all right, and all of that baloney, none of which, matters to anyone, including the performer. I have looked deeper and learned about Ronnie Scott, whose club in London was the first place I got to hear Barney Kessel, who also learned to play guitar in Muskogee, Oklahoma. But Ronnie Scott was playing somewhere, and probably his own joint, and there were very few people in attendance, and he said, gee, I should have stayed in bed. There are a lot more people there. I quit doing this next tune for quite a while because I had driven it into the ground, and I had pretty much worn it out up here. I mean, you get a kind of a smooth spot where the tune used to be on your brain. I know this can happen. The latest record that I have for sale is a live recording, and I took it upon myself to mention on that record that my first job was working in a morgue in Oklahoma, which is also, as I've already mentioned, where I started to play guitar. And we had one guy who actually had one of these smooth spots, right back here. This actually was more than a spot. It was like a quadrant that was flattened out. So of course I said, is this guy a musician? I'm lying, of course. But I did see this. I did work there. I just didn't have the wherewithal to say, is this guy a musician? I hadn't lived enough life yet, and wasn't likely that I was going to, my first job landing me in a morgue like it did. It didn't bode well for my future. So what I've done with this is change the key. They said that Louise was not half bad. It was written on the walls and window shades. And though she'd act the little girl, a deceiver, don't believe her. That's her trade. Sometimes a bottle of perfume, flowers, and maybe some lace. Men brought Louise 10-cent trinkets. Their intentions were easily traced, and everybody knew at times she cried. Other women like Louise, they get by. Everybody thought it kind of sad when they found Louise in a room. They'd always put her down below their kind. Still some cried when she died this afternoon. Louise rode home on the mail train, somewhere to the south, I heard them say, too bad it ended so ugly. Too bad she had to go this way. And the wind is blowing cold tonight. So good night, Louise. Good night. That's called Monterey. It's something else I haven't played for a while. It's written for a woman named Mona Ray who sold furniture in Santa Barbara. Doesn't take much to set me off. You know, I was watching Furry Lewis play one night, long time ago, and he was doing a tune I'm going to do later, but a real upbeat version of it, and in the middle of it, he flipped his guitar over and started pounding on the back of it while he sang, and it was the first indication I've had that you can have too good a time up here. You do have to be selective somehow. You can't just take every little thrill and try and turn it into a tune, because you'll be all alone before long. And I've had that experience, you know. You're just blowing your stack, you know, and having this great time, and you look up and no one else is blowing their stack. I was playing in Minneapolis on this amazing bill with Mama Thornton and Fred McDowell, John Lee Hooker, Doc Watson, and George Harmonica Smith. And George, I was sitting next to Fred because I had known Fred from a disastrous party a year earlier. And George Harmonica Smith started having too good a time, and this was in a football field, and the audience, this was, you know, it was terrible. The stage was, let's say, on the 50-yard line, and the audience was back behind the goalpost, so that it had a quality of the absurd that has, you know, I don't usually find that in the blues, but I sure did that night, and so evidently did George, who, as I've already said, was having too good a time, because he decided to close the gap. and jumped off the stage, which was quite a bit higher than this. And he made it, and Fred and I looked at each other, and he had a huge line on his, you know, on that bullet mic, you know, that you have with the harmonica. And he ran out as far as the cord would go, and there he was, all alone on the 30-yard line. And he took... But he's still having a good time, and he turned around and he started running back to the stage. And Fred and I looked at each other again, because he wasn't slowing down and he wasn't heading for the, you know, the stairs at the side of the. And so he just ran along like this, well, more like this, leaped in the air like that, and hit the front of the stage like this. Try and look cool when that next time that happens to you. Yeah. It's probably the most horrible thing I've ever seen. It was truly inspirational. You have to be really, you know, you gotta put some brakes on every now and then. This is that song that Furry Lewis was doing when he got too excited. Corina, Corina, where you been so long? Corina, Corina, where you been so long? I've been worried about you, babe, ever since you've been gone. I got a bird that whistles. not a bird that sings. I got a bird that whistles, a bird that sings. But if I ain't got cold wings, life don't mean a thing. Well, it's a real privilege to play here. These are frequently playing in a tent is the worst possible place you can be for sound. For some reason, this just works beautifully, and I really appreciate your being here and coming back. I hope to see you here next year. I've finished, it seems, with this kind of stuff all the time. I tried to quit it, but it didn't work. So I'd like to play it again.
Funding support for Tent Show Radio is provided by the Bayfield Inn. With 21 hotel rooms, over 25 vacation rentals, a lounge, on-site restaurant, and rooftop bar, there's something for you at the Bayfield Inn. More info at thebayfieldinn.com. And we're brought to you by Bayfield County Tourism. Find out how to get in touch with your inner wild at travelbayfieldcounty.com. And by the Cable Chamber of Commerce. Cable, the gateway to Bayfield County, where world-class trails, forests, lakes, and adventure await. visit cableforfun.com. That's cable, the number 4, FUN.com.
Leo Kottke and Tommy Emmanuel. I may never touch a guitar again. Well, folks, that's our show for tonight. Whether you beam it or stream it, we thank you for listening. We're as grateful as a guy who knows he's never going to get that kind of noise out of his guitar, so he can just relax about it. We'd love it if you come on up Bayfield Way or down or over or through for a live show one day. Details always available at bigtop.org. And you can visit me anytime at sneezingcow.com. Until next we share the air, remember, where I come from and here at Tent Show Radio, nobody ever says goodbye. They just say, well, I suppose.